Most religions evolve. Whatever theory of religious evolution we adopt, it has to be capable of explaining the astonishing speed with which the process of religious evolution, given the right conditions, can take off. A case study follows.
Cargo cults. In the life of Brian, one of the many things the Monty Python team got right was the extreme rapidity with which a new religious cult can get started. It can spring up almost overnight and then become incorporated into a culture where it plays a disquietingly dominant role. The cargo cults of Pacific Melanesia and New Guinea provide the most famous real-life example. The entire history of some of these cults, from initiation to expiry, is wrapped up within living memory. Unlike the cult of Jesus, the origins of which are not reliably attested, we can see the whole course of events laid out before our eyes, and even here, as we shall see, some details are now lost. It is fascinating to guess that the cult of Christianity almost certainly began in very much the same way, and spread initially at the same high speed.
My main authority for the cargo cults is David Attenborough's Quest in Paradise, which he very kindly presented to me. The pattern is the same for all of them, from the earliest cults in the 19th century to the more famous ones that grew up in the aftermath of the Second World War. It seems that in every case the islanders were bowled over by the wondrous possessions of the white immigrants to their islands, including administrators, soldiers, and missionaries. They were perhaps the victims of Arthur C. Clarke's third law, which I quoted in Chapter 2. Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. The islanders noticed that the white people who enjoyed these wonders never made them themselves. When articles needed repairing, they were sent away, and new ones kept arriving as cargo, in ships or later planes. No white man was ever seen to make or repair anything, nor indeed did they do anything that could be recognized as useful work of any kind. Sitting behind a desk shuffling papers was obviously some kind of religious devotion. Evidently, then, the cargo must be of supernatural origin. As if in corroboration of this, the white men did do certain things that could only have been ritual ceremonies.
They build tall masts with wires attached to them. They sit listening to small boxes that glow with light and emit curious noises and strangled voices. They persuade the local people to dress up in identical clothes and march them up and down, and it would hardly be possible to devise a more useless occupation than that. And then the native realizes that he has stumbled on the answer to the mystery. It is these incomprehensible actions that are the rituals employed by the white man to persuade the gods to send the cargo. If the native wants the cargo, then he too must do these things.
It is striking that similar cargo cults sprang up independently on islands that were widely separated both geographically and culturally. David Attenborough tells us that
anthropologists have noted two separate outbreaks in New Caledonia, four in the Solomons, four in Fiji, seven in the New Hebrides, and over 50 in New Guinea, most of them being quite independent and unconnected with one another. The majority of these religions claim that one particular messiah will bring the cargo when the day of the apocalypse arrives.
The independent flowering of so many independent but similar cults suggests some unifying features of human psychology in general. One famous cult on the island of Tanna in the New Hebrides, known as Vanuatu since 1980, is still extant. It is centered on a messianic figure called John Frum. References to John Frum in official government records go back only as far as 1940, but even for so recent a myth, it is not known for certain whether he ever existed as a real man. One legend described him as a little man with a high-pitched voice and bleached hair, wearing a coat with shining buttons. He made strange prophecies, and he went out of his way to turn the people against the missionaries. Eventually, he returned to the ancestors, after promising a triumphal second coming, bearing bountiful cargo. His apocalyptic vision included a great cataclysm. The mountains would fall flat, and the valleys would be filled. Old people would regain their youth, and sickness would vanish. The white people would be expelled from the island, never to return. and cargo would arrive in great quantity, so that everybody would have as much as he wanted. Most worryingly for the government, John Frum also prophesied that on his second coming, he would bring a new coinage stamped with the image of a coconut. The people must therefore get rid of all their money of the white man's currency. In 1941, this led to a wild spending spree. The people stopped working, and the island's economy was seriously damaged. The colonial administrators arrested the ringleaders, but nothing that they could do would kill the cult, and the mission churches and schools became deserted. A little later, a new doctrine grew up that John Frum was King of America. Providentially, American troops arrived in the New Hebrides around this time, and, wonder of wonders, they included black men, who were not poor like the islanders, but
as richly endowed with cargo as the white soldiers. Wild excitement overwhelmed Tanna. The day of the apocalypse was imminent.